Now, chapter 31, cardiac action potentials. So before we actually delve deep into the topic, we need to understand what fast action potentials are and what slow action potentials are. In fast action potentials, you have fast opening sodium channels which cause rapid depolarization. So if this is the time, the graph goes something like this, and there is a vertical line in which in very little time there is rapid depolarization. Whereas these fast action potentials, they happen in ventricular muscle cells. Whereas slow action potentials, they occur in SA node and the AV nodes. And they are characterized by a slow depolarization. See, there is time. It is not just a vertical line. It is a little oblique. So it takes time. Why is that? Because of long-lasting calcium channels which cause calcium ion influx. And okay, so there are essentially two types of different potentials that are seen in the heart. Slow potentials are seen in the pacemaker areas and SA node and AV node, and fast action potentials are seen in contractile and conducting cells. And then membrane potentials for the SA node. The sinus node, also called the SA node, is an ellipsoid strip of cardiac muscle that is specialized, and it is about 3 mm wide and all that. It is located in the superior posterior lateral wall of the right atrium, immediately below and slightly lateral to the opening of the superior vena cava. So the RMP of the sinus node is about minus 55 to minus 60 millivolts compared to the extra negativity of the ventricular RMP, which is about minus 85 to minus 90 millivolts. Why is this SA nodal potential positive? It is because the lesser negativity is because the SA nodal fibers, they are naturally leaky to sodium and calcium ions. So due to the influx of these positive ions, the electronegativity is neutralized. Intracellular electronegativity is neutralized. And the ionic basis of slow action potential. So because of the high sodium concentration in the ECF, as well as a moderate number of already open sodium channels, positively charged sodium ions, they leak to the inside. And they leak during the hyperpolarization phase. See, you can see here, it's going to negativity. Okay, this is hyperpolarization. What happens is, Hetzian channels, that is hyperpolarization, cyclic nucleotide gated channels, they open, which cause sodium influx. They're also called funny channels, and this sodium influx current is called funny current. And due to this small and gradual influx of sodium ions, the RMP moves from minus 60 or minus 55 to minus 40, which is about the threshold level. And then suddenly long-lasting calcium channels open and there is influx, okay? So due to which depolarization occurs. L-type, long-lasting type calcium channels become activated, and then they cause the action potential. So this self-excitation is because of the inherent leakiness of the sinus nodal fibers to sodium and calcium ions. And why does this leakiness does not cause constant depolarization? So this is because the L-type calcium channels, they become inactivated within 150 milliseconds after opening. And at the same time, as the calcium channels, L-type calcium channels get inactivated, the permeability for potassium increases. Okay, due to which there is potassium ion efflux. So both these effects reduce the intracellular potential back to its negative RMP and therefore terminate the action potential. And potassium channels remain open for another few tenths of a second, temporarily continuing movement of positively charged potassium ions out of the cell, which causes hyperpolarization, that is excessive negativity. And then hyperpolarization initially carries the RMP down to about minus 55 to minus 60. So why is this hyperpolarization not maintained? Because Hetzian channels. And then ionic basis of the fast action potential in the cardiac muscle. So it has a very negative value, about minus 85 to minus 90 millivolts. And then the threshold stimulus is about plus 20 millivolts, okay? So when there is a threshold stimulus, then the actual spike happens. What causes the long action potential? So the same fast voltage gated channels, when they open, there is a rapid influx of sodium ions, which causes fast and rapid depolarization. And there's an entirely different population of L-type calcium channels. They are slower to open and they are slower to close. They remain open for several tenths of a second. So during this time, a large quantity of both calcium and sodium ions, they flow into the interior of the cardiac muscle fiber, and this maintains a prolonged period of depolarization, which causes the plateau phase, okay? Further, the calcium ions that enter during this plateau, they cause the contractile processes in the cardiac muscle. And then immediately after the onset of action potential, so the cardiac muscle membrane, the permeability for potassium decreases because permeability for calcium is already increased. So this decreased potassium permeability may result from the excess calcium influx through the calcium channels. Regardless of the cause, the decreased potassium permeability greatly decreases the outflux of potassium ions and prevents the early return of the action potential down to its resting level. So when the L-type calcium channels close again at the end of 0.2 to 0.3 seconds, the influx of calcium and sodium reduces, due to which the permeability for potassium increases and there is potassium efflux, which causes repolarization and brings back the action potential voltage to RMP. This ends the action potential. And then as you can see in this graph right here, there is initially a rapid influx of sodium ions through the fast sodium channels, voltage-gated sodium channels, and then there is gradual influx of calcium ions. So this is an inward current of sodium, and then there is an inward current of calcium due to the opening of L-type calcium channels. And then this is during hyperpolarization, the K channels, and then it decreases while the calcium permeability increases, and as the calcium permeability decreases, the potassium efflux or permeability increases. So as you can see here, phase 0 is rapid depolarization due to the opening of the fast voltage gated sodium channels, and it reaches about plus 20 millivolts, and then initial repolarization due to the closure of the fast sodium channels, due to the opening of the calcium channels and closure of the potassium channels and sodium channels, you have the plateau phase. Opening of the sodium potassium channels, you have the repolarization phase. And then sympathetic and parasympathetic effects. So sympathetic effects, what happens is the stimulation of the sympathetic nerves, it releases norepinephrine at the sympathetic nerve endings. So norepinephrine stimulates the beta 1 adrenergic receptors. The main function of beta 1 adrenergic receptors is they increase the permeability of the muscle fiber to sodium and calcium. So there is increased influx of these sodium and calcium ions, which lower the threshold stimulus that is required. So the RMP becomes more positive. So this causes a positive resting more positive resting potential and increased rate of upward drift of the diastolic membrane potential toward the threshold level of self excitation. So this increases the heart rate. And in the AV node and AV bundles, increased calcium permeability makes it easier for the action potential to excite each succeeding portion of the conducting fiber bundles. So it decreases the conduction time from the atria to the ventricles. And the increase in permeability to calcium ions is partially responsible for the increase in contractile strength also of the cardiac muscle under influence of sympathetic stimulation. And then parasympathetic effects. So when you talk about parasympathetic effects, vagus is mainly a parasympathetic nerve and acetylcholine is released at the vagal nerve endings. So this greatly increases the permeability of the fiber to potassium ions, due to which there is greater potassium efflux. There is rapid leakage of potassium out of the conductive fibers, and this causes increased negativity in the fibers called hyperpolarization. So there is increased gap between the RMP and the threshold stimulus, due to which it is difficult to excite this excitable tissue. And the hyperpolarization makes the RMP more negative. And then if the vagal stimulation is hence strong enough, it is possible to stop entirely the rhythmical self-excitation of the node. And also, because of this parasympathetic stimulation, the safety factor for transmission of the cardiac impulse through the transitional fibers into the AV nodal fibers, it decreases. And finally, effect of drugs on the cardiac action potential. So if you're talking about sodium channel blockers, sodium, it mainly causes the fast depolarization, fast rise in the action potential. So if you're blocking it, it reduces the maximum rise of the action potential and decrease in conduction through the conducting system. And then when you talk about beta receptors, beta 1 adrenergic receptors, which are activated by noradrenaline, what they do is they increase the permeability of the cardiac muscle fiber to sodium and calcium ions. So if you are blocking it, so it reduces sodium and calcium entry in the SA nodes and the AV nodes, and it reduces heart rate and slows conduction. Potassium channels, what they do is they cause efflux of the potassium ions, and if you are blocking them, so you are prolonging the action potential, because the efflux is what is causing the action potential to come back to the RMP. So if you are not if you are blocking the potassium channels, so the plateau phase is continuing and it is taking more time to get repolarized. And then calcium channels, what they do, calcium channels mainly cause the plateau phase. So if you are blocking them, you are depressing the plateau phase of the action potential. And also calcium is what is responsible for the Frank-Starling law, and Frank-Starling law, we talk about increased inotropy. So if you're blocking calcium channels, so you're blocking the influx of calcium, so there is negative inotropism.